गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
कैमरा आरोप लेकिन कर दीजिए
सर। नमस्कार
हेलो
सर। नमस्कार
स्विच कैमरा कर दीजिए।
वेट करू छुआ माने आई थिंक ऐड है ना हंती समस्ते टिके सर 5 मिनट्स
ठीक ठीक
ठीक है सर।
वीडियो बंद कर दो। तुम वीडियो का काम हेलो
हेलो, आई थिंक वी शुड स्टार्ट नाउ। आई वेलकम टू ऑल आर लर्नर्स टू टुडे सेशन। एंड टुडे सेशन इज बेसिकली ऑन लीनियर मॉडल्स विच इंक्लूड इनपुट आउटपुट एनालिसिस। एंड टू टेक इनपुट आउटपुट एनालिसिस टुडे डॉक्टर मुरलीधर माझी सर इज विथ अस, एंड ही इज फ्रॉम जीएम यूनिवर्सिटी फ्रॉम इकोनॉमिक्स डिपार्टमेंट। एंड आई थिंक ही इज अ जॉइंट इन मैथमेटिकल इकोनॉमिक्स। सो टुडेज क्लास इज गोइंग टू बी वेरी मच बेनिफिशियल फॉर आर लर्नर्स। सो बिफोर स्टार्टिंग द सेशन, आई वुड लाइक टू से दैट टुडेज इनपुट आउटपुट एनालिसिस इज नथिंग बट इनपुट एंड आउटपुट आर द टू टर्म्स दैट इज एसोसिएटेड विथ एनी इंडस्ट्री। एंड टू नो वट शुड बी द लेवल ऑफ आउटपुट ऑफ ईच इंडस्ट्री विद एग्जिस्टिंग टेक्नोलॉजी सो दैट द टोटल आउटपुट गोल फॉर कंज्यूमर एंड इंडस्ट्रियल यूज इट्स प्रोडक्ट गेट फुल्ली सेटिस्फाइड। सो टू डील विथ दिस टाइप ऑफ प्रॉब्लम देयर इज अ इनपुट आउटपुट एनालिसिस एंड विच वॉज इन्वेंटेड बाय W.W. लियोनटिव। So now I request Dr. Muralidhar Maji sir to start the session. Please, sir. Sir, are you ready, sir?
Okay. Thank
yes,
you,
sir.
ma'am, for giving me the introduction. So first of all, I will welcome all the learners of this particular session. So dear learners, we'll start from the meaning that is input output model in economic analysis. You might be knowing that why it is a model and relating to input and output, because any industry, any production sector. Am I audible to all of you?
Yes, sir.
Am I visible to all of you also?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. So any industry or a set of industries are there in an economy generally, and they need input, they need object, they need material. So that creates a material demand by the entrepreneur, and by using this that they try to produce output, and that gives rise to revenue. So whenever we are using input, this gives rise to cost. And whenever we are producing output, this gives rise to income, which is nothing but the revenue we say in economics. So this input and output, indirectly it is saying us about the expenditure and income of industries, or also we can say it is saying us about the cost and revenue analysis. So how this particular relationship of using materials, incurring cost, generating output, giving revenue can be explained with the help of a mathematical setup that gives rise to a model. And that model is nothing but input-output model, or the expenditure-income model, or the total cost-total revenue model, we can see. Technically speaking, this input-output model or the expenditure-income model, it was first propounded by W.W. Leontief of Harvard University in 1951. And for that, he got Nobel Prize in 1973. So, dear learners, I can say that in input-output analysis, we say that suppose there are certain number of industries, construction industry, steel industry, transport industries are there. Construction industry using certain output of steel industry using certain output of transport industry. So the output of one industry is going to be used as input in another industry, and output of the second industry also going to be used as the input of another industry. Not only there can be two set of model, there can be many more industries which they have certain interlinkage, and that interlinkage establishes an inter-industry analysis. So we can say this input-output analysis is nothing but inter-industry analysis also, or inter-industry relationship, or we can also decide here their interdependence of the industries. So before going to explain you about the basic concepts of input-output model that is your transaction matrix or input output table or Hawking-Simon condition or open input output model or closed input output model or the determination of output with a given set of input, let me say what we can write about an interrelationship among the industry and how we can slowly enter into a matrix format about their interrelationship. Dear learners, before explaining you about this matrix format, I am assuming that you have certain idea about the concept of a matrix, the concept of determinant, the concept of non-zero determinant, and the inverse of a matrix. I will use these concepts while I am going to explain you about finding the total output by using certain input through a model. And this model is nothing but the Leontief model, simply we can say, or the input-output model. So here I can say suppose there are three industries I can say. One is the steel, another is the construction, and another is the transport industry, we can say. It is visible to you, dear learners. Steel, construction, transport. Here also I can write down the steel, construction, and transport. Transport industry. Steel industry requires certain input of steel industry. So here I can say there is interrelationship. Similarly, construction industry also requires certain steel. Here it also interrelationship. Transport industry also requires certain steel. Here it also interrelationship. Similarly, the steel also requires certain construction of godowns. Here I can say it has a relationship with the construction industry. And this construction also has a relationship with construction. Here I can say it is interrelationship. Here also transport industry also has certain relationship. We can say it is another type of relationship. Steel industry also requires car, everything or for transport. So we can say there is also a linkage. This construction also has a relationship with the transport. And this transport also has a relation with transport. Are you getting my point, dear students? So these points we can say, dear students, here you want to know, if we look into the row and if we look into the column, there are certain rows and there are certain columns. Dear students, here I want to say that for steel industry here, if we look into column-wise, the steel industry needs inputs from steel, inputs from construction, inputs from transport. So here I can write down, it is inputs. Are you getting my point? Okay. But here what is happening, if you go through the row-wise, this is nothing but output. Why we are talking it as input-output model? So whenever we are talking about the column-wise, this is the input. Steel industry requires certain steel from requires certain input from steel. Steel industry requires certain input from construction.
Okay, Govinda Digi is presenting today, but not clearly audible, sir.
Okay. So am I not audible?
Text message.
If I am not audible, please give a text. Okay, dear students, let me continue. So if you go through the row wise, we'll find out here the steel industry is using the output of steel. Construction industry is using the output of steel. Transport industry is using the output of steel. So whenever we are talking about the row, this is output. But whenever we are talking about the columns, you see here, this is input. So it is not in the form of a unit, because the steel industry requires different units of steel, different units of houses, different units of transport. Similarly, but if you look into the row wise, all these units are same. That's why output can be expressed in the form of a unit, whereas input cannot be expressed in the form of a unit. So here the steel industry, construction industry, transport industry using in this way the input and output. That's why the formula. That's why the model is called as input-output model. Now, writing down some numbers here, I can write down in this way, this model. For example, if I write down 50 steel units, if I write down 1,000 suppose, I'm writing down 1,500 here, I'm writing down it as 10, I'm writing down it as 2, I'm writing down it as 10, I'm writing it as 15, I'm writing it as 5, I'm writing it as 2. Okay? So here is no units. Units differs. So here is no units. Here is no units. There is no common units. What I want to say, there is no common units. Okay? But here I am saying about the output. This is the output of steel unit. So here I can say this is output. Are you getting my point, dear students? Are you getting my point? Okay. So this is how we can establish the relationship between input and that is the output. And this relationship through a particular coefficient determines about the inter-industry relationship expressed in the form of a matrix or a model. That's why the name is called as input-output model. Now, I told you that there are certain rows, there are certain columns. So columns say just about the inputs and the rows say just about the output. There can be objective question. Be careful, students. So the rows say just about the output and the column says just about the input. And this particular matrix, there are three rows and three columns. So the order of the matrix is 3 into 3. The order of the matrix is 3 into 3. So here, this particular matrix is called as a transaction matrix. This particular matrix is called as a transaction matrix. Are you getting my point? Or each item of this particular matrix, that is 50, 1,000, 1,500, 10, 2, 10, 15, 5, 2. These are nothing but the technical coefficient or the marginal input coefficients of production. Please write it down. There can be objective question for you also. So each particular item of this particular matrix or this transaction matrix is called as technical coefficient or marginal input coefficients of production. So before going to teach you about the finding the way how to find out the total output in a particular setup using a set of input, what assumptions are there that we have to see? Then we will go to writing down the model in a generalized format. So we can say the assumptions in the following way. What assumptions are taken by unit in its input-output model? So assumptions can be like, assumptions, please write down. Assumptions. No external economy or diseconomy. Three assumptions that I have taken. So inputs are used in fixed proportions and constant returns to scale, CRS. This is the second assumption. Third is, economy is divided into two sectors. This is the basic assumption. First is inter-industry sector. And the second is final demand sector. First is inter-industry sector, and the second is final demand sector. And point number four is all technological coefficients. Please write down what I am telling you. all technological coefficients are non-negative. Suppose, so with this, let me proceed further, that there are the total output of, we can say the total output of each sector total output of each sector, suppose there are n number of sectors, means n number of industries are there. So how to write it down? How to write down this value then? Now, have you written all this thing?
Text message ro kahi le liye screen pochari the text message re samne reply bhi paribe ko.
Please, if you are facing any problem, give your problem or write down your problem through your text message. Have you written all these assumptions?
Yes or no, chat ro likho.
Yes or no, please say to me. Okay, dear learner. So let me write down this particular matrix format. Now I can say that here I can say the industry. This is industry. Number
Please
of industry.
Again tell about the third assumption.
Okay. The third assumption is economy is divided into two sector economy. One is inter-industry sector. That means one industry is related to another industry within the economy, closed economy. That's why the name is inter-industry sector. And the second is final demand sector. Are you getting my point? Final demand sector. Okay? So in this way I can write down there are n number of industries, suppose. And here is also n number of industries supplying input. Now I can say, so here is n number of industry, here is also n number of industry. Here is the domestic demand, I can write down domestic demand. And the last part is your total output. Total output. This is the last column. Okay. So here I can say that the first industry is using X11. This is X12 dotted X1N. And I can write down the domestic demand as C1 or F1 somewhere else. In your book, you can find it out. Okay? So here I can write down for industry 1, I can write down this particular total output, that is X1 is equal to X11 plus X12 plus dotted X1N. X11 plus X12 plus dotted X1N. Please write it down, dear students. X1N. The second industry in this way, it can also use X21, X22 in this way, X2N, and the domestic demand is C2. And the total output is here, in this way you can find out, X21 plus X22 plus dotted plus X2N. Are you getting my point, dear students? Are you getting my point? In this way you have to write down. Similarly, for n number of industry, I can write down XN1, XN2, dotted XNN, and this will be equal to CN, and this XN will be equal to XN1 plus XN2 plus dotted XNN. Are you getting my point? Are you getting my point, dear students? So here I can write down this is your production. This is your input and this is your output. So the row says us about the output, whereas the column says us about the input. In this way we can write it down. So dear students, if you write down it in a matrix format, let me write down it in a matrix format, that is equal to, should I clear the blackboard now? Please say yes or no. Should I clear the blackboard? Because this is a complex method when we have to go slowly. Please say to me yes or no. Okay. So dear students, I can write down x11 or x1 that I got, that is equal to a11 x1 a12 x2 plus a13 x3 plus dotted a1n a1n xn plus the final demand, that is equal to f1. Okay, similarly I can write down x2 in this way, plus this will be equal to f2. In this way I can write down xn, so this will be equal to, write down xn yourself, this will be an1 x1 plus an2 x2 plus dot a, this will be ann xn plus fn. Got the point, dear student? In this way we can write it down. And at the end, the labor that is also required, I can write down it as l1 x1 plus l2 x2 plus l3 x3 plus dot a ln xn. Technically writing down L is equal to sigma I1 to J, that is equal to Li Xi. This is the labor demand. Okay. So if we try to write it in the format of a matrix, how to write it in the format of a matrix? Dear students, see here how I am converting it in the format of a matrix. Are you getting my point till now? Yes or no? Please write down somebody. Yes or no? Okay. So I can write down it as x1.
Sir, in the last L, why we won't add F?
This is the labor requirement, and here is no final demand. Okay. This is inter-industry. That's why there is no F. This is the primary input here I am added. That's why here we are not going to add any final demand. Because final demand for input is there, which has been produced. That's why we have added F. Got the point? Okay. So here I can write down, I am trying to convert this in the format of a matrix. Dear student, this will be x1, x2, dotted xn. So this is the format of a matrix. What is the order of the matrix, dear student? N into 1, n number of rows, 1 number of column, that is the order. Are you getting my point or not? This is 1 row, 2nd row, 3rd row, 4th row, n number of rows are there, and 1 column is there. So the order of the matrix, order here is n into 1. So here I can write down this coefficient in this way. You see, a11, a12, dotted a1n, a21, a22, a2n, an1, an2, dotted ann. This is the first part of the matrix. And this particular x1, x3, I can write down it as x1, x2, dotted accent that is equal to plus, I can write down it as F1, F2, dotted Fn. See here how I have converted it in the format of a matrix. What's the point? Please say yes or no. So dear students, what is this? This is per unit of work. Per unit of work of the commodity. Got the point? Should I move further? Okay. So by using this, how I am writing down the formula of the input-output model, then I will say you about what is an open input-output model, what is a closed input-output model, then what is a static input-output model, what is a dynamic input-output model in a simpler format. So dear student, so here I can write down here x is equal to, if I am converting it into simple x, x is equal to, this is a into x plus f. Got this idea or not? And L is equal to Li xi. That is the level. Okay? So, now moving further, I can say that here x is equal to ax plus f. That means x minus ax is equal to f. Okay? Now, if I take x as common, this will be I minus a into x is equal to f. Should I clear this portion, dear student? Please say yes or no. Should I clear this portion? The portion that I have written below? Please say yes or no.
Why this is I minus A?
I have taken X as common. So one means in the matrix, that is identity matrix, I. That's why I have written I in place of 1. So 1 means that is identity matrix in a matrix format. Got the point? Okay. Should I clear this written that I have written below? Okay. See here, dear students, how I am moving forward. So as x is our output, we have to find out the output with a set of input. So what will be the value of x here? X will be equal to f by I minus a. Are you getting my point, dear students? This will be equal to I minus a matrix minus 1, that means inverse, into f. This is the formula of input-output model. This is the basic formula. That is, the total output in an economy. That means x is equal to I minus a inverse or minus 1 into f. Okay, this is the formula. What is this x? Now, what is this x? X is equal to, you see, now, x is equal to, in this way, I can write down x1, x2, xn. This is equal to what? This is your output matrix. Got the idea? What is your f? F is equal to f1, f2, dotted fn. What is this? This is equal to your
final demand matrix. Okay, dear students. And what is I minus A? I minus A to the power inverse is equal to your inverse matrix. Got this point or not, dear student? This is equal to your inverse matrix. Should I move further, dear student? Should I move further? Please say yes or no. Please say yes or no. Okay. So let me move further by using this idea. So your x is equal to ax plus f. Or at last we got x is equal to I minus A inverse or the inverse of I minus A into final demand. That is the formula. You have to keep it in your mind always. With this basic formula, I will say you about what is a closed input output model, what is open input output model, what is a static model, what is a dynamic model. Dear students, if you know Odia, one sentence I will say here. Eitaku pura mone rakhibo. You should keep it in your mind. You should keep it in your mind. And this will determine what type of input-output model that we are going to use. Okay. So let me move further, dear students. Should I clear this? What I have written here now? Should I clear this? Please say yes or no. Please say quickly. Okay.
What is the time?
Wait.
Okay, I got it. 11:37. So, dear students, we know that AX plus D is equal to X. I'm writing in a different format where D is equal to, that is the F?
Wait, it's not.
Well, D is equal to D1, D2 dot F, Dn. I am writing in a different format using different types of symbols. Okay. So I can write down it again in this way. Why I have used that? That is equal to A11, A12 dotted A1n, A21, A22 dotted A2n, An1. An2 dot ann. I am writing it again for your reference, dear students. I am writing it again. My x is equal to here I am using x is equal to y1 y2 dot yn. I am writing it in this way. So here I can x means here I can write down y1 y2 dot yn plus what is the D is equal to D1, D2 dot A, Dn. That is equal to Y1, Y2 dot A, Yn. This is equal to my X. Got the point or not? So here, I am writing in a different format. So here, AX plus D. Earlier I was writing AX plus F. Now I am writing AX plus D, that is equal to X. Or this implies that D is equal to X minus AX. Again, I am writing down, that is equal to.
Now from where you are taking the value of X in Y1, Y2, Y3?
In place of X1, X2, Xn, I am writing now Y1, Y2, Yn. That is the output. Simply, I am naming it in a different way. Without writing x1, x2, xn, I am writing now y1, y2, yn. There is no problem writing that. I am giving it in a different name. Because in different books, different names are there. That's why I am acquainting all of you by using different connotation, different terms. Okay? So, this is I minus A into x. So, dear student, D is equal to now I minus A
or f is equal to, earlier it was there. That's why I am acquainting yourself with this type of terminology. So this will be equal to, dear student, here x will be equal to I minus A inverse into D. Got the idea? If you say yes, then I will move further, dear student. The same formula, I minus A to the power inverse into F. Earlier we were doing that. Now I am writing down I minus A to the power inverse into D. Okay? Please say somebody yes or no. What the point or no? What the point or no? Okay, dear students. So with that, let me write down what is certain conditions are there which must be satisfied. Then only we can find out the inverse of a matrix, as well as we can find the value of output by satisfying some conditions. And those conditions are called as Hawking-Simon condition. What is that Hawking-Simon condition? Should I clear this part, dear student? Okay. What is that Hawking-Simon condition? Hawking-Simon condition says that Hawking-Simon conditions, this must be satisfied to find out the value of the output, that is x, and here value of x that we have taken y1, y2, yn, that is n number of row and one number of column. So dear student, what is the Hawking-Simon condition? Point number one, condition number one, is visible to them or not? Okay. Condition number one, dear student, that is I minus A, the determinant of I minus A. Here we are trying to find out the inverse. What is inverse of a matrix? Inverse of a matrix is equal to adjoint of A divided by the determinant of A. That is the inverse of a matrix. So what is this determinant of I minus A? Hawking-Simon condition number one is that the determinant of I minus A must be greater than zero. Must be greater than zero. This is Hawking-Simon condition number one. Hawking-Simon condition number two. Dear students, all the diagonal elements, all the diagonal elements, please bear with me, these things are very crucial to attend your examination, because there will be objective type question from this part also. Be careful to this, dear students. So all diagonal elements of I minus A, all diagonal elements of I minus A matrix must be positive. This is condition number two. Should I clear this part yesterday now? Should I clear this part, the part that I have written below? Okay. So dear student, these two are the Hawking-Simon condition. Don't fear. I will solve certain numbers for you. Don't fear that how to find out this particular value. Got this point, dear student? Okay. So I minus A must be positive and all diagonal elements of I minus A must be positive. These are the two conditions of Hawking-Simon which must be satisfied in order to find out the value of output in an input-output model. Before solving you any example here now, let me say you about the types of input-output model. What are the types of input-output model? Let me say. Then we will go to solving certain types of example for the examination and how far you have grasped my way of teaching. So dear students, with that, let me proceed to the theoretical part again, the types of input-output model. So in an input-output model, that is a matrix model, we can say. And in that matrix model, some element like A matrix is there, the value of output is there, X matrix is there. With that, let me distinguish the type of input-output model or the classification of input-output model, the theoretical part, then we will go to how to solve one example, two example, three example, and number of example also I can solve for you. And I will show you the technique, how to solve a particular number and where to start in solving that particular number and what to remember and how to remember a particular model also. So if we look into types of input-output model, dear student, types of input-output model, the first type is open, or I can write on the open and closed input-output model, I/O model. I have written in a simple format, the open and closed I/O model. The second case is the static and dynamic input-output model. Okay, so the second part is, as I have gone through your syllabus is not saying this has not been covered, it might be covered in higher classes or in other classes. Let me say you all these particular four types of input-output model in a simple way. First of all, I told you the open in the closed input-output model. Then I will go to the open. The closed input-output model. Just remember the points, because some question will be this part from this particular part also, because objective question will be there. Be careful about this. If it is a closed input-output model, dear students, what does it mean? That means all the industries are self-adjusting. That means the steel industry is taking the output of construction industry, steel industry is taking the output of transport industry, and there is no final demand. Are you getting my point, dear students? So in a closed input-output model, write down please this particular line. In a closed input-output model, industries are self-adjusting. Please write down this. In a closed input-output model, industries are self-adjusting. Full stop. There is no final demand. There is no primary input sector. There is no primary input sector. That means all industries are endogenous sectors. Endogenous, exogenous. Exogenous means outside. Endogenous means inside. All industries are in endogenous sector. Got the point? So the way that we are writing down, X is equal to I minus A whole to the power inverse into F, what we were getting in our formula, this particular final demand sector, F is not there in a closed input-output model. Got the idea, dear student? Please write on somebody yes or no. Please show the thumb impression. Okay. So this is your closed input-output model. You are not getting my point. Mm-hmm. In a closed input-output model, all the industries are self-adjusting. Written this or not? There is no final demand. There is no primary input sector.
Can you repeat it again?
Okay. In a closed input-output model, please write down this particular line. Please write down this particular line. Again, I am repeating. In a closed input-output model, all industries are self-repeating. There is no final demand sector. There is no primary input sector. And all industries are endogenous in nature. What the point, dear student? There is no final demand in a closed input-output model. We have to solve some example. Be careful about this, dear student. That's why I'm repeating it again and again. There is no final demand sector in a closed input-output model. Be careful about this. Please give your thumb impression, some of you, if you have written it. Okay. Then comes about your open input-output model. The second part, the open input-output model. What is the open input-output model? In open input-output model, write down this line what I am telling you. In open input-output model, There is an exogenous sector. There is an exogenous sector. E-X-O-G-E-N-O-U-S. Exogenous sector or outside sector or final demand sector. Please write down this particular line. In open input output model, there is exogenous sector, outside sector, full stop. That means in open input output model, additional final demand sector is there. Additional final demand sector is there. That means x is equal to what I have written, I minus a whole to the power inverse into f. Please tell me, dear student, this is open or closed? Here is a final demand sector. This is open or closed? This is the formula of an open input output model. Dear students, be careful. I will not repeat it again and again. I am telling you, in an input output model where there is exogenous sector, where there is additional final demand sector, there is f. And this particular formula that I have derived by using a matrix at last, in my deliberation, in my teaching just before, this particular explanation is the example of, this particular formula is the example of an open input output model. Got the point, dear student? Please give a thumb impression. Okay. Then the third part is, dear students, the static input output model. The static input output model. Write down, dear student. Such model takes into account only current flows of input and output. Such model takes into account only current flows of input and output for a single period of time. I'm again repeating. In a static input output model, or such model takes into account only current flows of input and output for a single period of time. Full stop. Current output can be used. Please write it down quickly. Current output can be used for current consumption and or as current input in production of some other output Very simply, don't write what I am telling you now. Dear student, in a static input output model, remember, it takes into account the current flows. Current flow means for a single period of time. And here the current output is used for current consumption. And also, the current input in production for production of output. This is your static input output model. Your syllabus is not covering that part. For objective question, I have told you. What the point, dear student? Please give your thumb impression. Okay. Then the fourth part is the dynamic input-output model. In a dynamic input-output model, please write it down. In a dynamic input output model, current output can also be used. In a dynamic input output model, current output can also be used as an addition to. Current output can also be used as an addition to industry's inventory stock.
Sir, can you explain another time static input output model?
Okay. In a static input output model, listen to me carefully. In a static input output model, actually it takes into account only the current flows of input and output. Current flows means the current period. Okay, that means it is for a single period of time. Here the current output can be used for current consumption and or current input in production of some other output. Got the point, dear student? This is your static input output model. Current watta mone rakhibo.
Can you explain it with an example?
Current means the current year, dear students. If we are talking about the output production of steel industry for this year 2020, from 1st April to 31st March 2021, this is the current year. Okay, this is the current year. A financial year ranges from 1st April to 31st March. That is the current year. Got the idea? Okay. Then the fourth part is dynamic input output model. Please write down what I am telling you. In a dynamic input output model, please write down quickly. In a dynamic input output model, current output can be used as an addition to. Current output can also be used as an addition to industry's inventory stock and fixed capital formation. And fixed capital formation. That means in a dynamic input output model, actually, when the current output is used as an addition to the stock of an industry's output, that particular method of finding the value, we say it as a dynamic input output model. Okay, but your syllabus is clearly covering the open input output model and the closed input output model. Okay, dear students, then let me explain you some examples of this open input output model, how to solve the example. Are you ready, dear student? Should we move to the example part? How to solve? Should I move? Okay. Should I clear this part now? Because I have told you the types. I have given you the assumptions, the introduction, the technological matrix, technological coefficient, what is an open input output model, what is a closed input output model, what is the static input output model, and what is a dynamic input output model, dear students. Now I am giving you the example of open input output model, how to solve this particular problem. Dear students, two types of questions, two types of problems will occur before you while we are going to solve open input output model. That is, when technological matrix has been given to you, that means A matrix has been given to you, X is equal to I minus A whole to the power inverse into F, that is the formula. When A will be given, immediately you can find out I minus A. That means I is equal to identity matrix, 1, 0, 0, 1. This is the order of the matrix in case of 2 into 2. What is the order of 3 into 3 matrix? 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, and 0, 0, 1. This is the case of 3 into 3 matrix. If we are talking about the identity matrix of order 3 into 3. I will use that, dear students, now. Should I move? Please say, give the thumb impression. Okay. Now, dear students, example is suppose like this. See to this. A is equal to, suppose A matrix has been given to you. This is 0.3, 0.4. 0.2. Okay? Why should I write? Let me show it.
Oh, sorry, sir.
See here, dear students, this particular paper. Please write down quickly, dear students. Are you getting this? Okay. Visible or not, dear student? Okay, so our A matrix is 0.3, 0.4, 0.2, 0.2, 0, 0.5, 0.1, 0.3, 0.1, and final demand is 100, 40, and 50. Here the order is 3 into 3, here the order is 3 into 1. Find the final demand. Okay, let me write down. Let me write it down, dear student. So that time you see? Okay. So let me write it down again, dear students. Here A is equal to 0.3, 0.4, then 0.2. This is 0.2, 0, 0.5, 0.1, 0.3. This is 0.1. This is A matrix, and final demand has like 100, 40, and 50. What is the question? Find final demand. This is the question to you. Okay, dear student. Now, what do we have to do? What do we have to find out? What is final demand? So the question is that, what is the value? We know that solution. We know that I minus A whole to the power inverse into F. Into F is equal to X. Or here I can write down like this. That is your X is equal to x1, x2, x3. Why I have taken x1, x2, x3? Because it is 3 into 3 matrix. Okay. So that is equal to, what will be my identity matrix? 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1. This is my identity matrix. So here I can say I minus A. What is A? Here I can write down A matrix whole to the power inverse. I minus A whole to the power inverse into S. Got the dear student, got the point, formula? Okay. So this will be equal to A matrix, if we write down 1 minus 0.3, this will be equal to 0.7. Got the idea? This will be minus 0.4. This will be minus 0.2. This will be minus 0.2. This will be 1. That means 1 minus 0. 1. This will be equal to minus 0.5. This will be equal to minus 0.1. This will be equal to minus 0.3. This will be equal to 0.9. Its inverse into the final demand. What do you have? F is equal to 100, then 40, then 50. This is into. Got this idea or not? Got this idea or not? Please give your thumb impression. Please say, I minus A matrix, this has been given. I minus A. Okay. Now finding out the inverse. What is the inverse of this? Should I clear this part, dear student, now? I minus A because there is shortage of the space on my BB clock. So I can write now 0.7 minus 0.4 minus 0.2 minus 0.2 then 1 then minus 0.5 minus 0.1 minus 0.3 then 0.9 whole to the power inverse is equal to kt. This particular first we have to find out, then we have to multiply. Okay, so this will be equal to, first of all we have to find out the determinant. Determinant is equal to 1 by, what is the determinant value? 3 into 3, that is equal to 0.401. Got the idea, dear student? Then you have to find out the adjoint of A. Adjoint of A. How to find out the adjoint of A? You have to find out the minor. Then you have to find out the cofactor. Then you have to make a transpose. That is your adjoint of A. Got the point? Some of you should say yes. Some of you should say yes. Please give your thumb impression. Please give your thumb impression. At least you should know how to find out the inverse. Okay. So directly I am writing down the adjoint of A. So this is equal to 0.75.
One by 0.401 from where?
This is adjoint of A. This one I am writing down. This is the determinant I am writing down. I will divide each number by the determinant. So that's why I have written 1 by the determinant value. This is the determinant value. Hawking-Simon condition is saying it is greater than 0. Okay. So here I am writing down 0.16. Here I am writing down 0.42. 42. It is 0.61. It is 0.25. This is 0.40, this is 0.39, this is 0.62. Okay, in this way you have to give a line there. Got the point, dear student? Okay, then this will be equal to, you see, x is equal to x1, x2, x3. Is equal to 1 by 0.401. We have got it. So this is equal to 0.75, 0.23, 0.16, 0.42, 0.61, 0.25, 0.40, 0.39, 0.62 into the final demand, that is equal to your 100, that is equal to your 40, that is equal to your 50. See this? This is 3 into 3 and this is 3 into 1. See the order of the matrix. So both are confirmable. What will be the order of the result? 3 into 1. You see the Hawking-Simon condition, what is happening here? All the diagonal elements are non-negative. Another is the determinant is also greater than 0. So Hawking-Simon condition is satisfied here. So here x1 will be equal to, I am finding x1, then you have to find out x2 and x3 yourself. That is your homework. So my x1 will be equal to this row into this column. It's over here. First row into first column. That will be your x1 value. I am writing down, dear students, 1 by 0.401 into 0.75 into 100 plus 0.42 into 40 plus 0.40 into 50. This will be equal to 270. This is the value of x1. Then you have to find out the value of x2, then you have to find out the value of x3. That will be your answer. Anybody who has not followed this, please say this item into this item plus 0.42 into 40 plus 0.40 into 0.5 into 15. If you add it and divide it by 0.401, the value will be equal to 270. Similarly, you have to find out x2 and x3. In this way, you have to find out the value of the output in case of an input-output model where A matrix has been given to you. Where A matrix has been given to you. Now, the another problem I am telling you. Jodi A matrix dei nathibo, when A matrix has not been given to you, what you will do? If A matrix has not been clearly given to you in this particular format, but how to solve it? Then there is another technique I am showing it to you. Are you getting my point, dear student? Are you following my points? Okay. Should I clear this part? Please say yes. Okay. Because the time is running out. See here, dear student. Here is X, here is Y, here is X, here is Y. This is the two industry model in your syllabus. Here I am writing down 30, here I am writing down 40, here is 20, here is 10, here is the final demand. I can write down it as like this, 50, here I am writing down it as 30, here I am writing down the total output that is equal to 120, here I am writing down it as 60, okay? Then how to convert it in the format of matrix A? I told you. So dear students, how to find it out? Where A has not been given to you. Here A has not been given to you. Then how to solve it? See here, this 30 is a part of 120. So I can write it in this way, that is equal to 30 by 120. This 20 is a part of 120, so I can write down 20 by 120. Here I am writing down 40 by 60. Here I am writing down 10 by 60. This is your matrix A. If you write it down, this will be 1 by 4, this will be 2 by 3, this will be 1 by 6, and this will also be 1 by 6. See to this? You got A matrix? Okay. Then find out I minus A. Okay? Your I matrix will be 1, 0, 0, 1, minus A. This will be 1 by 4, 2 by 3, 1 by 6, 1 by 6. Okay? This will be equal to 3 by 4, minus 2 by 3, this will be equal to minus 1 by 6. This will be equal to 5 by 6 in this way. Okay. See to the Hawkinsiman condition. What is happening in Hawkinsiman condition? The determinant of I minus A. Hawkinsiman condition must be greater than 0. What is I minus A here? I minus A, if you cross multiply it, this will be equal to 15 by 24. Minus 2 by 18, that is equal to 37 by 72, greater than 0. First condition of Hawkinsiman satisfied. The second condition, all the diagonal elements. The diagonal elements like 3 by 4 and 5 by 6. Diagonal elements 3 by 4 and 5 by 6, both are greater than 0. What the point, dear student? So both the conditions of Hawkinsiman are satisfied. Now, let me clear this particular part. Got this? Please say, give your thumb impression. Please say yes or no. Okay. Now, suppose the new demand, that is your final demand, new demand is equal to your 80 and 40. Okay, then how to find out the value of the output, that is Z. So dear student, I can write down Z will be equal to I minus A whole to the power inverse into D. Okay, what is I minus A here? This will be equal to 1 by 37 by 72. This 37 by 72 is the determinant value I found out during the first Hawking-Simon condition. So this will be equal to 5 by 6 into 80 plus 2 by 3 into 40. 5 by 6 into 80 plus 2 by 3 into 40. The second part is 1 by 6 into 80 plus 3 by 4 into 40. This is your 40. So in this way, we have to draw a line here. Are you getting my point? So this will give you the value of x, that is x1 and x2. Value will be equal to, if you add it, then you will get the value. So that is equal to 1 by 37 by 72 into, this will be 400 by 6 plus, this will be 80 by 3. Then the second part is 80 by 6 plus 120 by 4. If you sum it, then you will find out the value of x. So this is your self-x plan. You have to find out the value of x1 and x2. Got the point, dear student? Got the point? Value of x1 and x2? Okay. Now, technically, some technical point I am giving you. Should I clear this part now, dear student? Some technical point I am giving you. See here. So, what is this? You see here, we have written it as x minus ax is equal to f. In this way we have written. So we have taken I minus a into x is equal to f, or x is equal to I minus a law inverse into f. We have taken this. Dear student, what is this x? If we are writing down x minus ax is equal to, what is this x? What is this x? See here. This difference, actually this difference is giving you, this is the total output and this is the input. I can write down it as, dear student, this particular part is production, this particular part is consumption of input. So the total part, are you getting my point or not? Here I can write on net production. Are you getting my point? This particular part must be enough to satisfy the demand. Demand is equal to F. Okay. So this is the crux of the problem. Okay. This is something about your introduction to input-output model, solution of two industry I told you, then Leontief model I told you, and this particular formula, Hawking-Simon condition, all those things I told you. Now question arises, dear students, what is a closed economy model? Write down. In a closed Leontief model, write down. In a closed Leontief model, whatever I am telling you, please write down quickly. The timing is running out. In a closed Leontief model, there is no final demand, and the closed Leontief model here x is equal to ax only. There is no final demand. There is no final demand. That means what? Here I can say that x minus ax is equal to 0, or I minus a, if I take x as common, this is equal to 0. Dear student, there is one objective question, be careful. This particular model is also called as closed loop model. Closed loop model. Remember it. This particular model is also called as closed loop model because there is no final demand. Got the point? Now, how to write it down or how to explain it? Suppose matrix A has been given to you, like your 0.2, like your 0.3, then this is your 0.2, 0.2, 0.6, 0.4, 0.6, 0.1, 0.4. This is your matrix A. Here we have to write down in this way. You see, if I write down I minus A, if I write down I minus A in this way, how to find it out? This will be 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1. This is I minus A. In this way, you have to write down. Okay, dear student. Now, in a closed Leontief model, write down. In a closed Leontief model, there is no external demand. Full stop. The matrix I minus A is usually not invertible. Bracketed. Otherwise, the only solution would be. Otherwise, the only solution would be x is equal to 0, 0, 0. There is only one, there is only internal consumption. Similarly, for determination of market prices, similarly, for determination of market prices, similarly, for determination of market prices, let P is equal to P1 dotted PN. Similarly, for market prices, please write down. P means the price which ranges from P1 to PN. The price vector. The price vector. And PI is equal to, I can write down, the relative price of the product of industry assigned. So here P1 is equal to A11 P1 A12 P2 plus dot A A11 PN. Similarly for P2, this will be A21 P1 A22 P2 plus AN2 PN. Okay, sorry. This will be
what
equal to P1,
price?
This will be equal to P2.
What is relative price?
Relative price means PI is equal to relative price of the product of the industry. That means when one industry is buying the product of another industry, that is called as a relative price. Okay? So here I can say, there will be a question, dear student, be careful from the closed model. That's why I'm telling you. So A1N P1 AN2 P2 ANN PN. The formula that we have read. So this will be equal to P minus A is equal to P. Okay? P minus A is equal to P will be the matrix. If the number has been given in terms of price, if the number output bahar karuthalo, you are finding out the output earlier, but if the value is given in terms of the price, they will ask you to find out the price. So the same formula you have to use, instead of X here, you have to use the value of P. That is the technique. So here I can write down it in this way, that is equal to P minus P into, or I can say P into I minus A is equal to 0. Okay, so this is how we have to write it down. The matrix I minus A, here I can write down bar. Why I am writing down bar? Because it is not invertible. It will be equal to 0. Since, kahi kemti hava? Why it will happen? Since, you see here, dear students, I minus A bar, I minus A bar into 111 is equal to 00. Write down. One can show that. One can show that. Come on. Implies that there is also a solution. There is also a solution when P is not equal to 0, 0. When P is not equal to 0, 0. Sorry. 1 minute I will take, dear student. Since, write down, since with P is equal to T into P for T is greater than 0, T is greater than 0 is a solution, comma, is a solution, comma, only the relative price between, only the relative price between the different products has a well-defined meaning. Thank you, dear students. If there is any doubt, You can go for texting, and if possible, all the materials also I will give it to your office, OSOU office.
A bar.
Huh?
This
bar, A bar, because here it is a constant, A. Are you getting my point? That's why I have written I minus A, that is equal to 0. So I have written it as 0. So here it is not possible to find out the inverse. That's why I have written A bar. Okay, dear student? So if possible, if possible, I will also give this handwritten materials to OSOU office so that they can show it through your group or through your any channel to get it. And the books that I have covered, that is particularly the Taro Yamani book, Mehta Madnani book, and the materials that has been uploaded to your site for you. Also, I have gone through certain YouTube in delivering all these materials to you.
Thank you, sir. Sir, I would like to thank you so much. You make the complex topic in a very simpler manner, and the session was very, very wonderful, very much wonderful. I think our learners must benefited for you from your lecture. And dear learners, if you have any queries, then please ask in the chat box.
Okay, dear learners.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir.
Thank
dear
you,
learners,
ma'am.
Dear learners, please ask if any query you have. Actually, everything is crystal clear. I think they must know each and every point that you have explained.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you once again, sir, for sparing your valuable time. Thank you, sir. Yes, sir. Okay, sir. Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Sir.